Good evening and welcome to the spring lecture of the Wheaton Center for Early Christian Studies. We have a few more seats here in the front, so you're welcome to come forward. My name is George Kalantzis, and I'm the director of the Center for Early Christian Studies. Before we come to our guest for the evening, I would invite Provost Jones to come and give an official welcome.
It is my delight to welcome all of you here to this special lecture. Evangelicalism, I believe, at its worst, has believed that we alone are the carriers of the Christian message, that we don't need the early church. We've occupied a position of historical forgetfulness and of disconnection from the broader Christian world. And I am grateful that in the life of our institution, we have, I think, matured to the place of a broader vision of the church while being enthusiastic about maintaining our evangelical distinctives. We're delighted to be enriched by conversations with a wide array of fellow believers in the Christian community. And we're particularly grateful that due to the generosity of wonderful donors who are members of our broader institutional family, that we've been able to establish the Institute for Early Christian Studies. We've had a distinguished line of lecturers here, and I hope some of you have been to prior lectures and will attend to future opportunities. The Center for Early Christian Studies connected at all levels of our institution in undergraduate, master's, and doctoral programs is a place for conversation about what evangelicals can learn from broader connections to the earliest roots of the Christian church. And we're grateful for how already the center has enriched life here at Wheaton College. We're particularly blessed, Metropolitan Callistos Ware, to have you here tonight. We're honored by your presence. And so we want to extend an official welcome to you on behalf of the president and trustees of Wheaton College. And we're grateful for members of the broader Chicago metropolitan community to be here. We pray that this will be a unique opportunity of positive engagement as Christians over the resources that come from the earliest parts of our common heritage in the church. So we're grateful that you're here. Let me introduce our chaplain, Steve Kello, who will open our meeting in prayer tonight. Thank you and welcome.
Please join me in prayer. Great God and loving Lord, we acknowledge and confess that you are the one who creates, redeems, and sustains. You are the one true living God who rules and reigns over all. So in our prayers and with our lives, we submit to your lordship. With thankful hearts, we bless your holy name. Tonight, we are especially mindful of all that Christ followers share together across ecclesiastical boundaries and theological differences. What a delight it is to celebrate our common commitments and allegiances, our shared interests and concerns. On this evening and in this venue, we thank you for the opportunity of thinking together, sharing together, and learning together. Since you are the source of all truth, we gather together with the ultimate purpose of knowing your mind and heart with our human limitations. We pray that our quest for understanding would be characterized by humility and patience. Forgive us for our pride and insensitivity. Forgive us for our arrogance and self-sufficiency. Enable us by your Holy Spirit to receive from you and from each other what you would have us know and embrace and declare even this evening and because of this evening. Father, our prayers tonight include prayers for the needy around the world, those who are suffering, those who are struggling for the most basic necessities of life, the people of your world, for them we pray. Ours is a needy world with war and famine and poverty and unrest. And then enlighten us even this night to the needs of our own, which may have been forgotten or neglected. The need to love you more, the need to love our neighbors more sincerely. We pray our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
We have seats forward if you want to come. It is my distinct pleasure to welcome all of you to our spring lecture, this event. Before we come to the more formal presentation, if you want to be informed about future events, we have some cards like this that you can fill out. Give us your name, your email. We promise you we'll not spam you, but we will invite you and make you aware of future events. At the end of his talk, the Metropolitan has graciously agreed to receive a few questions, so start thinking about them, not as he speaks, but towards the end. It is with great pleasure and great honor that we welcome His Excellency, the Most Reverend Metropolitan Callistos of Dioclea. Metropolitan Callistos was born in England, and he was educated at Westminster School, London, and at Magdalen College, Oxford, where he took a double first in classics, and then went on to read theology. In 1965, he was awarded the degree of Doctor of Philosophy at the University of Oxford. He joined the Orthodox Church in 1958, and was ordained deacon in 1965, being given the new name of Callistos. In 1966, he was ordained to the priesthood, and later in the same year, he took monastic vows at the monastery of St. John the Theologian in Patmos, Greece, of which he continues to be a member. Returning to Oxford in the autumn of that same year, he founded the Greek Orthodox Parish of Holy Trinity. And in 1967, he was promoted to the rank of Archimandrite, and in 1982, he was consecrated titular bishop of Dioclea, becoming one of the assistant bishops of the Orthodox Archdiocese of Thyatira in Great Britain under the Ecumenical Patriarchate of Constantinople. In 2007, he was raised to the rank of Metropolitan. For 35 years, the Metropolitan had taught at the Faculty of Theology at the University of Oxford as Spalding Lecturer in Eastern Orthodox Studies. In 1917, he became Fellow and Tutor in Theology at Pembroke College at Oxford. During 92 through 94, he was the Chairman of the Board of the Theology Faculty at the University. During the 2003 to 2006 years, he was chairman of the board of directors of the Institute for Orthodox Christian Studies in Cambridge. Metropolitan Callistos is widely regarded as perhaps the world's leading theologian in Eastern Orthodox Church today. He's an active in work of Christian unity, not only a prolific scholar, but a prolific interlocutor in these discussions. From 73 to 1984, he was a member of the Anglican Orthodox Joint Doctrinal Discussions, and in 07, he was appointed the Orthodox Court Chairman of the International Anglican Orthodox Theological Dialogue. He has served as Chairman of the Orthodox Co-Chairman of the Preparatory Commission for the Orthodox Methodist Theological Dialogue, and in 06, he has been a member of the International Commission for Theological Dialogue between the Orthodox Church and the Roman Catholic Church. Metropolitan Callistos is widely known by his many books, but none, I would say, more than his two primers on the Orthodox Church, one called The Orthodox Church and the other, The Orthodox Way. Among his other writings, he is now working, and he has worked throughout the years on the Philokalia, and it is our distinct pleasure to have him today give us a lecture on Orthodox and Evangelical dialogue. What have we to learn from one another? Metropolitan Callistos, thank you. We still have seats forward, so if you feel like it, you can come. This is not a Baptist congregation, so we don't have to fill in the back. So you're welcome to come forward.
Friends, let me begin this evening with some words neither from an Orthodox Christian nor from an Evangelical Christian, but from a Roman Catholic, Cardinal Sunens. He has said, "In order to unite, we must first love one another. In order to love one another, we must first get to know one another." That sums up, in a nutshell, the purpose of our Orthodox Evangelical dialogue, as of every inter-Christian or indeed interfaith dialogue. We are seeking to get to know one another better, so that we may come to love one another more fully, and so may be enabled by God's grace to fulfill the prayer of our Lord Jesus Christ for his disciples, that they all may be one. Nowadays, we often hear the word dialogue used in the title of my lecture tonight. Some people are in favor of dialogue. Others, certainly in the Orthodox Church, are against dialogue. For myself, I am strongly in favor of a dialogue that is sincere, a dialogue of truth, without evasion and without compromise. And let me tell you why I am in favor. Half a century ago, a highly instructive book was written on the Christian understanding of the human person. Still well worth reading, too much neglected. The author was a Scottish philosopher, John McMurray, and the book was entitled Persons in Relation. His theme was this: personhood is relational. As persons, we are what we are only in relation to other persons. No one isolated, cut off from others, turned inward, is truly a person according to the image and likeness of God, the Trinity. Not that John McMurray actually mentioned the Trinity, but it would have greatly strengthened his argument had he done so. In the early church community, there was a common phrase, unus Christianus, nullus Christianus, one Christian, isolated, cut off from the others, is no Christian. And we could extend that. Una persona, nulla persona. One person, isolated, cut off from the others, is no true person. So John McMurray writes, the self exists only in dynamic relation with the other. The self is constituted by its relation to the other. It has its being in its relationship. And he continues that there is no true person unless at least two persons are communicating with each other. To be human is to be dialogical. And he ends, I need you in order to be myself. Many of the same points have been made more recently by leading Greek Orthodox theologian John Zizioulas, Metropolitan of Pergamum. The very word for person in Greek indicates this relational character of personhood. The word for person in Greek is prosopon, and that means face, countenance. I am only a true person if I face other persons, if I look into their eyes and let them look into mine. Now, we should apply all this not only to individual persons, but to church communities. Isolated, cut off from other Christian communities, no ecclesial group is truly fulfilling its vocation in Christ. Each Christian community should be willing to say to the others, we need you in order to be ourselves. Herein lies the vital, compelling importance of inter-Christian dialogue. Now, at first sight, Orthodox and evangelicals appear widely different, even opposed. But in fact, we share in common far more than might at first seem evident. We share a common faith in God, the Holy Trinity, a common faith in Jesus Christ as fully and truly God, fully and truly human, a common faith in his virgin birth, his miracles, his sacrificial death on the cross for our salvation, his bodily resurrection, his second coming. We share a common faith in Holy Scripture as inspired by God and wholly truthful. But for neither side does this necessarily imply fundamentalism. We share a common faith in the divine ordering of marriage and the family, a common conviction that sexuality is indeed a gift from God, but a gift to be used within the lifelong commitment of marriage. We share a common approach to the problems of homosexuality, bioethics, and euthanasia. Yes, there are significant divergences between us, but they are not as great as we might suppose. Some time ago, I heard the Anglican Bishop of London, Richard Charters, say that there are two kinds of Christians. The first kind believe that Christianity is a revealed faith. The second kind believe that you make it up as you go along. Now, on that distinction, both we Orthodox and evangelicals come down on the first side. Of course, as an Orthodox, I allow for the fact that there are many variations within evangelicalism, notably the difference between the Arminians and the Calvinists, I am firmly Arminian, if you want to know. And also the difference between charismatics and non-charismatics. I suppose I also come down on the charismatic side there. Orthodoxy, compared with evangelicalism, is indeed much more uniform in doctrine and in its forms of worship. But we too have differences among ourselves, especially in our attitude to non-Orthodox Christians, in our approach to the question of Christian unity and the ecumenical movement. Please take note that in the title of my address tonight, I do not say just, what have evangelicals to learn from Orthodox, but what have we to learn from one another? Dialogue, if it is to be truly such, is always mutual, never just one-sided. Now tonight, I would like to explore three areas, and this is by no means an exhaustive list. In the discussion afterwards, please feel free to mention other things that seem to you of particular importance. I would like to speak about Church and Eucharist, secondly, Scripture and Tradition, thirdly, the work of Christ. When I was ordained priest, I asked the ordaining bishop for his guidance in my future ministry. And he said, though I think he is not the first person to have said this, always have 3 points in your sermon. So I shall follow him tonight. Actually, I think it's quite enough to have 1 point in a sermon, and a lot of sermons I hear don't seem to have any point at all. When I was consecrated bishop, I asked the chief consecrator for his advice about my episcopal ministry, and he said, at the end of the service, always make sure you fold up your own vestments. Don't leave it to the deacons. Well, 3 points then. Church and Eucharist. What is the church here for? What is the unique function of the church? What it alone does, and which no one and nothing else can do? We may answer, the church is here to proclaim salvation in Christ. That is true, but it is an incomplete answer. We are not here merely to proclaim. Jesus did not tell his disciples, say this. At the Last Supper, he told them, do this. The basis of the church is not just words, but an action. The action of the Eucharist, to which indeed baptism is indissolubly united. So we Orthodox say that it is through these two primary sacraments of the Church, baptism and Eucharist, that salvation is made available to us. While on our side, yes, there is certainly needed the response of faith. So we Orthodox think of the church as a Eucharistic organism. The church becomes what it is when it celebrates Holy Communion. Unity is not something imposed from above by power of jurisdiction. Unity in the church is created from within through communion in the body and blood of our Lord. Now, this means that the Orthodox approach to the church is strongly Eucharistic, and to understand how we look at the Eucharist, let me take a sermon delivered by St. Photius, Patriarch of Constantinople, around the year 864. He describes the impression made upon him by a newly built and decorated church. First, he mentions the delight and wonder felt by the worshipper on entering the courtyard outside the church. With its decorations, he says, the worshipper stands as if rooted to the ground. The facade of the church is a new miracle and a joy to see. But when with difficulty, continues Photius, one has torn oneself away from there and looked into the church itself, with what joy and trepidation and astonishment one is filled. It is as if one had entered heaven itself. And he continues to describe how the figure of Christ could be seen above in the dome, and in the apse of the church, the figure of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God. Now, we notice here, and this is something characteristic of Orthodoxy, the emphasis upon the visual. Grace is transmitted to us not only through the ear, but through the eye. We notice the place of beauty in our Orthodox worship. The value of the physical and the material. And this is, of course, expressed through the use Orthodox make of icons and relics. And behind this, we see a strong doctrine of creation. As it says in the Genesis account, God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. The Greek translation in the Septuagint says, kala lian, and kalos means not only good, but beautiful. So rather than just saying it was very good, which is a slightly flat translation, we could say it was altogether good and beautiful. This emphasis upon the goodness and the beauty of creation is, of course, highly relevant for the present-day ecological crisis. But the most important theme that I would like you to notice in the account of Photius is his phrase, as if one had entered heaven itself. For the Orthodox, the church at prayer during the Divine Liturgy is heaven on earth. In one of the best-known commentaries from the Byzantine era on the Divine Liturgy, written by St. Germanos of Constantinople in the 8th century, he begins, "The church is an earthly heaven in which the heavenly God dwells and moves." And it is particularly during the celebration of the service of Holy Communion that we Orthodox feel this element of the earthly heaven. Similar language is included in the legendary account of the conversion of Russia. Prince Vladimir of Kiev sent out envoys to all the different countries of the world to discover how they worshipped God and which was the true faith. He was not yet Christian. And this was what his envoys said when they returned home about the service that they had attended in Constantinople in the great cathedral of the Holy Wisdom, Hagia Sophia. "We knew not whether we were in heaven or on earth, for surely there is no such beauty anywhere on the earth. Only this we know, that God dwells there among humankind, and that their worship surpasses that of all other peoples, for we cannot forget that beauty." Now, that story may be legendary, but it is significant that in the story, what converted Prince Vladimir to the Christian faith was the beauty of the divine liturgy, the sense of heaven on earth. In the words of St. John Chrysostom, "The church is the place of the angels, of the archangels, the kingdom of God, heaven itself." The bishop of the Russian church in England, now dead, Metropolitan Antony, has this to say: "The church is vast, so vast that it holds both heaven and earth, so vast that all people of all nations, of all cultures, of all languages are its home." So this is central to the Orthodox understanding of the Church and the Eucharist. When we pray, we are always both living and departed, united in a single congregation. Hence, in our worship, we always have prayers for the departed. We always ask for the prayers of the Blessed Virgin Mary and the saints, because we feel them as members of the same community, just as we ask for the prayers of one another among the living, so we feel free to ask for the prayers of those who have gone on to the other world. Not as doubting the mediation of Christ, the one Savior, the only mediator between God and mankind, but because they are members of the same community with us, embraced in the same unity of love, and so we spontaneously ask them to pray for us. Let me share with you my own experience when I first entered an Orthodox church. I had been brought up as an Anglican, and when I was 17, one hot summer's afternoon, I was wandering through a part of London that I hadn't previously explored. I saw a church that I had never noticed before, and out of curiosity, I went inside. It was, in fact, the Russian church in London, As it was Saturday afternoon, they were holding, as the Russians do, the vigil service in preparation for the Lord's Day. When I first entered the church, coming in from the brilliant sunshine, it seemed like a dark cavern. And I had the impression that the church was empty. There were no pews in it, just an expanse of polished floor. Then I realized after a time, as my eyes grew accustomed to the gloom, that the church was not in fact empty. There were a few people, not very many, standing near the walls, mainly elderly. And then there were icons on the walls with lighted lamps in front of them. Across the east end of the church, there was a screen with many lighted candles in front of it. Somewhere out of sight, there was a choir singing. And then from behind the screen, there emerged a deacon, and he began to intone one of the litanies. My initial impression that the church was empty was then succeeded by an entirely different impression. I felt the church was not empty, but full. I felt with an overwhelming conviction that the church was full of invisible worshippers. I felt that we, the small, visible congregation, were being taken up into an action much greater than ourselves. I felt that Christ was present, the angels were present, the Mother of God was present, and the saints. I felt the unity of heaven and earth. Now, that is what we Orthodox wish, first and foremost, to share with our evangelical brothers and sisters, this sense of heaven on earth. Much of this will inevitably seem strange to evangelicals, even unacceptable. It is, however, not altogether alien. I think, for example, of the hymn of Charles Wesley, "Let heaven and earth combine, angels and men agree." That's exactly what is happening in the Divine Liturgy. What do I feel that the evangelicals in this area might offer to me as an Orthodox? The first thing that occurs to me is the sermon. The other day, I was exploring some of the 17th century churches in the city of London, designed by Christopher Wren, built after the Great Fire of 1666. And what impressed me was that in each church there was an enormous pulpit, high and lifted up, with a great sounding board over the top. And the holy table for the Eucharist was tiny and was at the back, the east end, overshadowed by the pulpit, almost out of sight. Now, if you go into Orthodox churches, you will often find no pulpit at all. There isn't a pulpit in our Orthodox church in Oxford. I just preach from the sanctuary steps. And if there is a pulpit, usually it's not at all prominent. Now, sermons are preached in Orthodox churches, more here in the USA than in the old countries, but the sermon is not usually seen as very important. I would extend this point. Yes, we Orthodox have a marvelous liturgy, but often it is very incompletely understood by the people. Often their participation is instinctive rather than articulate. And that is not so much the case for the Orthodox over here in America, but it's certainly the case in the old countries. The evangelicals can help us Orthodox to develop an understanding of the faith that is more conscious, more reflective, above all, more personal. Now I turn to scripture and tradition. We Orthodox often describe ourselves as the Church of Holy Tradition. Here, the immediate and justified response of an evangelical might well be, what about Scripture? It is important, therefore, for us Orthodox to remind the evangelicals, but also to remind ourselves, for too often we forget this, our Orthodox Church is also a Church of Holy Scripture. I remember once when I was on the island of Patmos in the monastery of St. John, I was sitting and working in the library, and two American gentlemen came in wishing to photograph various manuscripts, and they took no notice of me, assuming that I didn't know any English, and they took their photographs and kept turning the lights on and off, which slightly irritated me, and I tried to read. And they talked in loud voices. And one said to the other, do these guys ever read the Bible? And the other said, oh no, they just read legends about the saints. And at this point, I felt it was time to intervene. So I looked up and said, we do sometimes read the Bible. And the two gentlemen fell immediately silent, blushed very red, and continued their work photographing without exchanging a word. Perhaps that was a little unkind of me, but afterwards I thought, yes, but do we show as much reverence for the Bible as we should? Do we know it as well as we should? Incidentally, let me share with you another memory from Patmos. I came down one day into the courtyard and I found a group of American students. Perhaps they were from Wheaton, I don't know. And they said to me, do you speak English? And I replied, yes, a little. And after a time they said, you speak English very well. And I said, modestly, I try my best. And finally they said, do tell us, how did you learn your English? And truthfully, I replied, I just picked it up. To return to scripture and tradition. Here is what St. Gregory of Nyssa says in the 4th century. We treat the Holy Bible as the test of every dogma and rule, accepting only such things as agree with the meaning of Scripture. And here is what, a few years later, St. John Chrysostom says, that which the Scriptures affirm, the Lord himself has said, And so even if someone were to rise from the dead, or an angel were to come down from heaven, they would not deserve more credence than the scriptures. And here is what is said in 19th century Russia by Metropolitan Filaret of Moscow. The only pure and all-sufficient source of the doctrines of faith is the revealed Word of God contained now in Holy Scriptures. Everything necessary for salvation is stated in Holy Scriptures. Holy Scripture, being the Word of God Himself, is the only supreme judge of controversies. The decisions of councils are to be tried by the Holy Scriptures. The traditions of the Church are to be tried by the Holy Scriptures. In the Orthodox Church, every church, on the holy table, within the sanctuary, always there is the book of the Gospels. The book of the Gospels is carried in procession at matins and put out for all the faithful to come up and venerate it. Again, the book of the Gospels is carried in procession at the liturgy during what is known as the little entrance. But having said all that, in all humility, we Orthodox must examine ourselves. Do we live up to the standard set before us by Gregory of Nyssa, John Chrysostom, and Filaret? We venerate the Gospel book, but do our people really know what lies between its covers? There is, I have to admit as an Orthodox, a tragic gap between Orthodox principles and Orthodox practice. And here the evangelicals can certainly help us. If only we really knew the Bible as they do. In the 18th century, one of the great saints of the Russian Church, Tikhon of Zadonsk, says, "If an earthly king, our emperor, wrote you a letter, would you not read it with joy? Certainly with great rejoicing and careful attention. But what he asks is our attitude towards the letter that has been addressed to us by no one less than God himself. You have been sent a letter, not by any earthly emperor, but by the King of Heaven. And yet you almost despise such a gift, so priceless a treasure. To open and read this letter from God," St. Tikhon adds, "is to enter into a personal conversation, face to face, with the living God. Whenever you read the Gospel, Christ himself is speaking to you. And while you read, you are praying and talking to him." Now, that is certainly what we Orthodox believe, but the evangelicals can help us to appreciate much more vividly the personal character of Scripture. You can help us to be in daily life genuinely biblical Christians in a way that we are not all too often today. Orthodox listen to the Gospels read liturgically in church, but we lack, on the whole, the practice of Bible reading at home, either individually or together as a family. Let the example of the evangelicals inspire us. What then are we to say about orthodoxy as the Church of Holy Tradition? The older view, Roman Catholic but also Orthodox, was to speak of two sources of revelation, Scripture and tradition. Tradition was seen as something added to Scripture. And this is naturally an approach that most evangelicals find disturbing. Today, however, most Orthodox avoid this way of speaking, and they would stress that there is only one source. Tradition is not a second source of revelation. Tradition is simply the way in which, through the centuries, Scripture has been understood, prayed, applied, and lived out within the Church. Do not evangelicals accept, in slightly different terms, such a view of tradition? Such a view of tradition, surely, is not in conflict with the principle of sola scriptura, by Scripture alone. But certainly there are still problems. Orthodox, for example, believe as part of tradition in the bodily assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary. And evangelicals might well ask us, where is that to be found in Scripture? We do not make this into a dogma formally defined as has been done by the Roman Catholic Church, but certainly it is part of our living tradition. So there's plenty to be discussed. Much could be gained if, to a greater degree, Orthodox and evangelicals would study the Bible together. I was reading Jim Packer the other day, and he says with great emphasis, we should do everything together that we are not obliged to do separately. The fundamental Orthodox principle in biblical study is that we interpret Scripture through the Church and in the Church. But that means we attach great importance to the way Scripture has been understood by the fathers and by the saints. That, of course, does not exclude the use of critical study of the Bible. I notice with pleasure that the Orthodox, or rather the patristic, way of interpreting the Bible has become a matter of increasing interest to evangelicals. And a notable testimony of this is the production of the multi-volume Ancient Christian Commentary on Scripture, edited by the evangelical Dr. Thomas Oden, though with Orthodox cooperation. For example, the volume on the opening chapters of Genesis, which is a crucial part of the Bible, that has been prepared by an Orthodox scholar, Father Andrew Louth. I hope that the foundation of the Wheaton Center for Early Christian Studies will promote joint study of Scripture by both evangelicals and Orthodox. Now I come, thirdly, to the work of Christ. And here I call to mind a conversation I had recently in a railway train. A man came down and sat opposite to me, and he fixed me with an icy stare. And after a time, he said to me, "Are you saved?" Now, how did I answer? Well, you'll have to wait to the end of my talk tonight, but I may tell you then. But let's return to the work of Christ. Here it is tempting to make a series of sharp contrasts. The evangelicals, it is often said, concentrate upon the cross. The Orthodox more upon the incarnation and the resurrection. The evangelicals, it is said, see atonement as primarily a matter of penal substitution. The Orthodox speak rather of the victory of Christ, Christus Victor. The evangelicals say, Christ for me. The Orthodox say, Christ in me. In the evangelical tradition, a distinction is made between justification, sanctification, and glorification, although they are not separated. In Orthodoxy, there is no clear distinction made between these three. I noticed afterwards, not at the time, that in the index of my book on the Orthodox Church, published by Penguin Books, the word justification doesn't appear at all. That wasn't deliberate, but it was significant. The Orthodox regard salvation primarily as a continuing process of deification, of theosis. The evangelicals, we are told, see salvation and the work of Christ in transactional and forensic terms, the Orthodox rather in organic and therapeutic terms. In Orthodoxy, there is more emphasis on love as the motive for the incarnation, rather than upon justice, honor, or glory of God. Anselm and Calvin don't talk so much about the love of God. The evangelicals, we are told, are often twice born with great emphasis on conversion. Orthodox, on the whole, are once born. Though for myself, yes, I did have a conversion experience, but that was before I'd become Orthodox. In Orthodoxy, conversion is seen not so much as an event, as a lifelong process. Metropolitan Antony of Souros, whom I've already quoted, says, conversion begins, but it never ends. Now, there is an element of truth in these contrasts. However, in every case, I would want to say, yes, but we must be careful not to exaggerate them. Again and again, what we need to say is not either or, but both and. For example, substitution. Yes, the Orthodox do not make great use of this model for salvation, but it is clearly present in Holy Scripture. As St. Paul says, 2 Corinthians 5:21, for our sake God made him, that's Christ, to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And the theme of substitution is certainly present in the Fathers. St. Athanasius of Alexandria speaks of Christ as antipsychon, meaning the one who laid down his life instead of us. Anti. So substitution is there in our Orthodox tradition and we should take it seriously. And then, if we take as a model of salvation theosis, deification, it has, yes, surely a clear scriptural basis. 2 Peter 1:4, we are called to be partakers of the divine nature. John 10:34, our Lord quotes Psalm 82 in the Septuagint numbering. Those to whom the word of God came were called gods, and the scripture cannot be nullified. But beyond these particular quotations, there's the whole Johannine notion running right through the gospel, from the prologue to the discourse before Christ's passion, of sharing in the glory that you have given me, says Christ to the Father, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one, John 17:22. And then we have the Pauline notion of being in Christ. That's not just a metaphor, it's to be taken with realism. When we read Romans 3 on justification by faith, we Orthodox think forward to Romans 6, where it is said that through baptism we are united with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. Justification means uniting with Christ, Christ dwelling in us and we in him. All of you who have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ, Galatians 3:27. So this theme of deification, sharing in the life of God, is certainly in Scripture. And it's a theme in the Wesleys. Think of Charles Wesley's hymn, Since the Son Hath Made Me Free, where he says, change my nature into thine. That is exactly what we Orthodox mean by deification. But we Orthodox have much to learn from the evangelicals, a keener sense of the personal experience of salvation, of commitment, a keener desire to make a personal commitment of our life to Christ. Not just to say Christ died, but to say Christ died for me. A greater sense also of urgency in sharing my faith with others through evangelism and mission, both organized and personal. I'm sure we Orthodox have a lot to learn here. But as before, we must remember the need to avoid sharp contrasts. We do have in Orthodoxy a sense of personal encounter with Christ. Read, for example, the marvelous mystical poems of St. Simeon the New Theologian, writing in the 11th century. We do have home renewal movements. The Lord's Army in Romania, the Zoe movement in Greece, the Orthodox Youth Movement in Lebanon. We do have missions in Kenya, Uganda, Korea, and Japan, but we could be doing much more. As I draw to a close, let me quote some words of Dr. Bradley Nassif, who I'm happy to see here this evening. He says that the Orthodox Church is the most thoroughly evangelical church in all the world because of its incarnational Trinitarian vision of life. As an Orthodox, I do believe that of my own church, but recognizing the gap between theory and practice, I acknowledge that we Orthodox need the help of our evangelical brothers and sisters in order to become more truly what we are. We need you in order to become ourselves. And now, before I end, what did I say to the man in the train? Are you saved? Now, of course, I didn't answer, no, I'm not saved. That would be a denial of Christ, my Savior. Yet I hesitated to say, yes, I am saved, as if it was all finished and completed. For I recall that St. Paul, long after his conversion on the road to Damascus, expressed the fear that after I have preached to others, I might find myself rejected. 1 Corinthians 9:27. So, did I answer, I don't know? He might have retorted, that's a fairly feeble answer. You'd better go and find out. And if you don't know, what do you mean by going about dressed like a clergyman? So what I said to him was, I trust that by God's grace, I am being saved. Not I am saved, as if it was all finished, but I am being saved. That expresses our Orthodox approach. Salvation we see as a process, not a single event, but an ongoing journey, a pilgrimage that is only completed at the moment of death. So that was my answer to the man in the train. But if you can think of a better answer, please let me know. Thank you.
We thank you for your words, and as if there are questions, we're going to take a few. Would you come to the microphones so that we can both be recorded and also can hear? That is also to remind you that this lecture tonight will be posted. Actually, it was broadcast live over the web, but it will be posted on the center's website, and you're welcome to come and listen to it again. So if you have questions, would you please come?
Could I ask an able-bodied person to bring me up a chair, please?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
And if we can try to keep our questions as questions and not statements with a question mark at the end.
That would be wonderful.
Thank you.
Sir, could you please tell us your thoughts or the thoughts of the Orthodox Church on celibacy?
Sorry, I didn't quite understand the question. Could I tell you?
Your thoughts on celibacy or the thoughts of the Orthodox Church on the whole
on celibacy? Yes, yes. In the Orthodox Church, we certainly attach high value to marriage. We regard that as one of the sacraments. And in the marriage service, we put more or less equal stress upon, on the one side, the procreation and bringing up of children, and on the other side, upon marriage as a sacrament of mutual love between husband and wife. And we do not distinguish either of those as being the primary aim of marriage. And in the Orthodox Church, our clergy the parish clergy are, for the most part, married, though you have to marry before ordination. You have to make up your mind where you are going. We also have, yes, within Orthodoxy, a strong tradition of the monastic life. What one does not find so much discussed within the fathers or among Orthodox today is the question of the single life. There are, after all, many people who would have liked to get married, but somehow they never met the right person, or people whose marriage has broken up. In our day, tragically, this becomes more and more frequent. And so there are a great many single people who have not chosen the celibate life as a vocation, but find themselves in this predicament. And so the question is, how can we help the single people to turn what is a situation that they have not chosen into an opportunity that they do freely use? We would certainly see both marriage and celibacy as ways of serving God. What depends, what decides the matter is the personal call that each receives from God. It's perfectly possible to be called both to marriage and to the priesthood. Here we differ from the Roman Catholics. But in the Orthodox Church, bishops are all of them monks. That's something that has existed. Well, from the 6th century, bishops have had to be celibate, but from the 14th century, they've also had to be in monastic vows. So we see celibacy as a way of life blessed by God, but equally, we believe that married people are also called by God. Both are vocations filled with grace.
I would just like to say I enjoyed every word that you said and agreed with most of them. And I would like to say, since you were called a bishop, my name is Tom Cannon, and it's spelled C-A-N-O-N. And I could be a canon in the Anglican Church. Is that correct? Or the Episcopal Church?
Yes.
I could be canon. That's just a little joke, okay. The last part of your talk tonight was very interesting to me because you used the term being saved. And I believe that very, very much. But during your talk, I came up with this thought for that. Instead of saying being saved, conversion begins and never ends till eternity. And I think that's a little bit like saying being saved. And I just wanted to communicate that to you. But it was very helpful in being here.
Thank you. Thank you for those words and of confirmation. And I would agree that God is faithful. He will not change. His gift of salvation is not withdrawn from us. But we have free will, we may prove unfaithful, and we may fall away from him. But in the age to come, there will be no more danger of falling away. Then we can say we are saved. But I would at the same time believe that there is progress in the age to come. And one might even say that conversion goes on in the age to come. We learn to turn to God in new ways through all eternity. Our view of the future life, insofar as we can understand it at all, should not be static but dynamic. As C.S. Lewis, whom it is appropriate to quote in this place, writes at the end of the series of the Narnia books, The Last Battle. He says, "And for us, this is the end of the story. But for them," that is the children who have now passed into the next life, "this is the beginning of the story that never ends, that goes on, and in which every chapter is better than the one before." Now, that is also the view taken of the future life, a continuing discovery, an ever deeper conversion. That view is also found in the Fathers. Saint Irenaeus says, "Even in the age to come, God will always have new things to teach us, and we shall have new things to learn. Even in eternity, we shall never come to the point where we can say to God, 'You are repeating yourself. We have heard it all before.' It will continue to be surprises and discovery. Insofar as I can imagine anything about heaven, that's the way I think of it."
And Father, when I speak to my Protestant friends about the Orthodox Church in discussions of especially about unity and especially the commonality between evangelicalism and Orthodox, the conversation almost always turns to the subject of the communion, specifically along the lines that the evangelicals are most interested in unity because they have an open communion and will allow the Orthodox to take communion, while the Orthodox are interested in exclusivism and hegemony because they will not accept communion at a Christian church, an evangelical church, and will not allow evangelicals to take communion at their own church. So I was wondering if you could discuss the relevance of the taking of the Eucharist or the lack thereof in the Orthodox Church as it relates to questions of Christian unity.
It is for us a cause of deep sorrow as Orthodox that we cannot yet share communion with other Christians. We would love to do so. But we feel that as long as there are serious differences of doctrine between us, it would not be realistic to receive communion. I know there is a different way of looking at this. Some would say the sacrament of Holy Communion has great power. Therefore, even though we still disagree, let us have communion together, and that will help us to attain the unity which we do not yet possess. Now, I take seriously that argument, but as an Orthodox, I cannot entirely share it. We Orthodox feel that Holy Communion should not be seen as a means to an end, but it should be seen as the crown and fulfillment of our unity. So as long as we are still separated in our understanding of the Christian faith, alas, we have to refrain from having communion together. because the act of Holy Communion cannot be isolated from the totality of our church life. When we receive communion, we are expressing exactly what it is to belong to our particular community, and we are expressing in the act of communion our total faith. Now, of course, the Holy Communion belongs to Christ, not to us. But Christ has entrusted the Holy Communion to the Church, and therefore we feel we cannot responsibly share in communion until we have grown more closely into unity. Now, this was a problem that faced the Christian community from the very beginning, and you will find in the New Testament already the first Christians are wrestling with the issue of who should be allowed to receive communion and who should not. So this is not new. And I hope and pray for the day when we can all have communion together. That is certainly the purpose of all our dialogues, all our work for unity, the restoration of visible communion. That is our end. But I have to say, as an Orthodox, the time is not yet.
What happens to the material universe itself in the ultimate future of God's redemptive plan? And what do you think about the relationship between evolutionary biology, Christian faith, and the Bible?
In 3 minutes.
Those are large questions. Easier to ask than to answer. We are taught that at the end, at the second coming of Christ, there will be a bodily resurrection, that our souls will be united to our bodies. That is quite clearly the teaching of Scripture held by the Christian community through the centuries. What is the exact relationship of the resurrection body to our present body? That is much more difficult to answer, and that is a mystery that we don't yet fully understand. But we do believe that there is a real continuity between our present body and the resurrection body that we shall have. It will be, in some genuine sense, the same body. But that does not necessarily mean that it will be formed of the same material particles, because, after all, there is a continuous process of flux. When we die and are buried, we Orthodox don't practice cremation, then our bodies dissolve in the earth, and by organic process, they are dispersed among the elements, and those elements are then incorporated in the bodies of others. So it cannot be that we have simply a body formed out of the same material particles as now. And in any case, the material particles of which our bodies are formed are constantly changing through our life. And in any case, material particles are centers of energy, not just objects. So I follow the suggestion of Gregory of Nyssa that throughout our life, though the bodily constituents are constantly changing, yet our body has a continuing form. When you see a photograph of somebody as a child, and then as a young man, and then as an old man, recognizably, this is the same person with the same body. It may have changed, but it does not change out of recognition. There is a kind of continuity of form, even if the material elements change. C.S. Lewis uses the analogy of a waterfall. In a waterfall, the water is continually changing, but the waterfall has a shape which, through all the change, continues undestroyed. So we can speak of it as being the same waterfall, though it is formed of different elements. So that's as far as I can go in understanding the relationship between our present body and our resurrection body. We recognize ourselves in this life through our bodies. We shall do the same in the world of the resurrection. But at the resurrection, our body will be a spiritual body. That phrase, of course, comes from St. Paul, 1 Corinthians 15:44, if I remember rightly. Now, by a spiritual body, St. Paul did not mean a dematerialized body. He didn't mean a ghost. He meant a genuinely physical body, but one that would be filled with the grace and power of the Holy Spirit, as was the case with Christ's body after the resurrection during the 40 days before his ascension. So that's about as far as I can go in a short answer about the resurrection body. What about evolution? I would say, as a Christian, it depends what kind of evolution, because there are different theories of evolution. In any theory of evolution, I would wish to retain the uniqueness of the human person. We are not just superior apes, because we are made in the image and likeness of God, and that cannot be said of the apes and of the other parts of God's creation. So any theory of evolution which excludes the possibility of humans being in some way unique would seem to me unacceptable. But there are theories of evolution which do not necessarily take that form. There's much more to be said, but the day is growing to an end. Yes, it is. I was given a room in the guest house called Eventide.
Thank you for your patience. And since you are asking questions that take a whole term to answer, we will take one more, and then we'll bring our time to a closer.
So make it an easy one.
Your Excellency, I was brought up in a black church in here in America, and then I made my way through the young Reformed movement within evangelicalism into the Orthodox Church. And one of the things for us when I was an evangelical at the time was, not just necessarily us, but within evangelicalism, they have what is called worship wars, sometimes between... Worship wars between traditional hymns versus contemporary music, like guitars, that sort of thing. I was wondering what place, as usually wherever the Orthodox Church goes, we attempt to baptize the culture and take in the things that can point to God. What place is there in our church for contemporary music where we find ourselves today? I'm not saying, you know, introducing to Divine Liturgy or in the Vespers, Matins, things like that, but what place is there for contemporary music in the Orthodox Church? Is that easy? If it's not, sorry.
Right. Thank you very much. Now, so far as the Greek tradition goes, we are still using Byzantine chant. And therefore, in the liturgy you will not hear contemporary music, and you certainly won't hear guitars. You will hear in Greek churches over here in America the use of organs, but you won't hear that in Europe. You won't hear that among the Orthodox in England or in Greece or Russia, except on the island of Corfu, where they do use organs. And one lady told me that her parish on the island of Corfu even has a brass band at the liturgy. I must go along and hear it. But it has to be said that in general, in the Greek tradition, we are using Byzantine music. And there is room for personal reinterpretation in the way that is sung, but of course it is not exactly contemporary music. Now, in the Russian church, it is different, because in the Russian church, with the use of harmonized music and of mixed choirs, there are certainly many composers from the 19th and 20th century. Tchaikovsky wrote music for the liturgy, to quote just one example of someone known also as a secular composer. And that is certainly going on up to the present day. There is still new church music being written in the Russian tradition. Admittedly, it is being written for a cappella choirs without the accompaniment of instruments, which is in our tradition. But that shows you that there is a continuing use of music. How far this music incorporates motifs from modern secular music is another question. Probably it does not do so very much. I think in earlier ages, there was a much closer link between the music of the liturgy and the kind of things that people sang in secular contexts when they were having parties or in their own homes. But today there's been a certain division there. I noticed that the Greek churches here in America often do use harmonized music rather than the Byzantine chant. And I suppose their music is adapted from the Russian music, so that there again there is some room for contemporary compositions. But it's only a limited use. You might also ask why we don't use modern artistic styles in our icon painting. Some people have made efforts in that direction, but they haven't been altogether successful. So how we are to make a fuller use of contemporary culture is something that we need to go on thinking about. God has still more things to teach us. Thank you.